come with us now, if you dare, down a rickety staircase into a dank, dark basement. What awaits? The Saturday Night Freak Show.
Thanks for listening to the Saturday Night Freak Show podcast. Every Saturday night, you can catch a new episode on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, TuneIn Radio, and more. Even Google Play, I think, right? So these are the internet radio irregulars.
Superstar lineup.
Who will bring
Whatever.
It to you.
You forgot your role.
Well, the superstars aren't like, half of them aren't here tonight.
Well, they're not they're superstars. We're the part-timers. Travis.
Michaela.
And I'm Colin. And every week, one of us picks a movie, and then we watch it, and then talk about it for your listening pleasure. And as a special bonus listener, all through the month, and happy Halloween, by the way, all through the month of October, we've been going through each of the superstars' favorite top 10 Halloween horror movies, or horror movies of all time. And you can hear Travis's picks on our Bad Seed episode. You can hear Sean's picks on our Return of the Living Dead 3 episode. Holly's picks on our Cabin in the Wood episode, and you'll hear mine tonight after our final wrap-up. So stick around after the show, and I'll give you the rundown of my top 10 favorite horror movies for today. So I picked the movie tonight, and we watched Dracula.
Dracula.
This is the 1979 version of Dracula, starring Frank Langella, Laurence Olivier, who you may remember from Hamlet. Everybody saw Hamlet.
I did.
Clash of the Titans.
I saw that shit.
Donald Pleasance, who I believe was just coming off.
Who was in everything in the 70s. He was in every single movie in the 70s. You didn't know that? Every single movie, Donald Pleasance is somewhere back there.
Yeah, chewing the scenery and sometimes all the food at the same time.
Just with his English accent. That's all he needs. It's like, oh, man, English accent.
Well, I have to go back and look. But
it's kind of like the Danny DeVito of the BBC in a weird way.
Well, you put him in a top hat and away he goes. But I think that this is maybe the first thing that he did since Halloween, right? Halloween was 1978.
Mm-hmm. And then this was
and
the
this
next
was
thing.
79. So Halloween was his big bump back up into major Hollywood studio movies.
This is what he used all his Halloween clout on.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
But this was just like the American studio system, right?
Yes. Yeah. This movie was directed by John Badham.
Badham?
Anybody know what?
Badham.
No. Badham.
He scored a giant hit in 1977. It was called, you're going to go like, oh, that makes so much sense. Saturday Night Fever.
Oh, my God. I love that movie. I didn't even know that.
Yeah, I love that movie. 100%.
I love that movie. I had no idea.
Yeah.
So
crazy.
Would John Travolta
Isn't that
have
crazy
been
how you
like
could love a
villain
movie
for...
and not like...
You know, that's really funny because...
it's like so weird.
I was going to say Frank Langella's hair was very Barry Gibb in this movie. It was so Barry Gibb. That it's so funny. It's shared universe,
yeah,
maybe?
Shared universe. Perfectly coiffed for a guy who spends most of his time sleeping in coffins.
Doesn't move, except when he's on the horse. It's like the only scene
yeah,
in the
movie. Yeah, yeah.
So this was the next film or... Yeah. So he did Saturday Night Fever. Did he also do Staying Alive, the sequel?
No, that was Stallone.
That was Stallone.
Yeah. Frank Stallone did the soundtrack, and Sylvester directed it.
Nice.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Well, that's why that movie is the way it is.
Well, this movie came about. Okay, so let me go back a little bit here and give you how we got to Dracula 1979. Because there was a play written in like 1928 by a guy named Hamilton Dean of Dracula, which was a condensation of the novel by Bram Stoker. So Bram Stoker's widow was still alive at that point in time. And she approved it. She didn't like the...
She sued the Nosferatu.
Right, the Fritz Lang silent film. So she approved of this play, but the play, like, I mean, the novel, if you've ever read it or if you've seen, you know, Bram Stoker's Dracula or any of the adaptations where, you know, I mean, it moves around a lot. It's a very, it's like a found footage novel, right? You're reading these letters as people experience these events.
If you're reading any book like before 1900, you're reading letters.
Yeah.
Everything was found footage back in the day.
Right?
It's
that
crazy.
Was how to get it, make it seem like it was this
June
really
19,
happening.
19 or 18.
Yeah, because it's War of the
this
Worlds.
This is to my sister. Yeah, because like when you read Frankenstein, it's a captain writing a letter to his sister about Frankenstein. It's like, this is so fucking like...
Right. And all of
this is a long letter, dude. Like,
yeah, right. I know.
Jesus Christ.
They didn't have, you know, they didn't see people. They were on the other side of the globe. They wrote like books.
Yeah, it's almost like
paragraphs and paragraphs, pages and pages, I should say.
Yeah, it's weird. Text. It's almost like they just the concept of just writing a story. It's like, well, no, it needs to be like a letter to someone. Has to be telling the story. It's like it can't just be like an invisible narrative just telling you, like, well, but isn't somebody?
Yeah, because I mean, I'm not familiar a whole lot with like Jules Verne stuff, but I mean, I know H.G. Wells usually has like a first person narrator through a lot of his stuff. You know, H.P. Lovecraft, obviously.
Letters.
Not maybe like, well, Edgar Allan Poe. Is that somebody explaining all... like?
I mean,
usually it's someone telling someone else, like recounting a story to someone else. Really...
I guess that's whatever. I made a broad generalization. But
but it's weird that, like, for that time period, the story had to be grounded in reality somehow for the people. Like, because now that's not something we would ever even notice in film now. So it's weird that that was, like, such a standard at the time.
Yeah. But we've moved, I mean, found footage is kind of like our answer to that, right? We've adapted the new technology to, like, do the same thing. It's like the way to really believe that this is happening. Yeah, so where's the found footage Dracula movie? Okay, that's probably a bad idea.
I don't know if you can do it. Because now you have to worry about the same way I was like, well, why would your letter to your sister be fucking 400 pages long? Mm-hmm. You know, now you have to worry about like, why would they be videotaping?
Oh, could you do Dracula like in text format?
No, that'd be
like,
horrible.
No, I mean, just as like
it's like Sherlock thing. And those bubbles are on the screen next to the characters.
Yeah. It's a copyright 2016 Saturday Night Freak Show on that. We overdo it. I know there was a guy.
So it'd be
who,
like Mina. I'm on my way emojis. To Castle Track.
Right? Yeah. Well, there was a guy
who... Send me a text,
who,
like, oh, is that a new emoji? Yeah. Dracula emoji.
We need one of those, right? There was a guy who actually, I think, like, every year they would do this. There was, like, a blog or something where he was publishing pages from the novel on the days that they actually, were dated. So it was like, cool. You would read along, like, day to day is, like, what was happening in Dracula. But so anyway, this was a hit in England with a guy named Reginald.
Reginald.
What was his name? It was on a trivia game that we played last night.
Reginald.
Totally blanking.
Reginald. That's how I say it.
But since it was a hit, the Americans said, hey, we got to have that thing over here. And so they had a guy named John Balderston rewrite it. John Balderston also wrote, you know, like, I don't know, he didn't do The Wolfman, but like The Invisible Man and maybe Bride of Frankenstein. He wrote.
Yeah,
like,
Wolfman was Kurt Siodmak.
Right. But he wrote a number of those. Maybe it was The Mummy. He wrote a number of Universal horror movies. So he made this play, and this is where fortune smiled on this undead creature because they got Bela Lugosi to play the part, and that became like a huge success on Broadway. And so Universal Pictures said, hey, we need to make a movie out of this. And in 1931, they released a movie called Dracula. And so history repeats itself in 1977.
Well, we got through all the like Hammer shit, right? Like Dracula AD was 1972. And then
there
was one more Dracula after 1972. That was the Seven Brothers versus Dracula.
There was the Satanic Rites of Dracula, so, aka damn, it has another title.
The Evil Hounds of Dracula, whatever. I don't know. It could be anything. You could do anything, Dracula. Like,
well, that was Christopher Lee, right? Mm-hmm. That's what you're getting at. Christopher Lee for an entire generation.
Well, because this tried to like tried to make almost like another realistic. Like, this wasn't the forget your like superhero Dracula movies. You know, this isn't. We're gonna pop one out. This tried to return Dracula to its. Kind of
the Christopher Lee ones?
No, this movie, the movie we're talking about, Frank Langella's.
Oh, okay. Well, wait a second. I just want to clear up real quick that the in between, you know, we were saying between 31 and 77, Christopher Lee became and defined Dracula for, you know, what
TV
from 1958 until
for color Dracula
75 or something like that. Mm-hmm. He played Dracula. I looked it up. It said he played it 10 times, but I counted 7. Hammer vampire movies and one Spanish, the Jess Franco Count Dracula. But so there was a renewed interest in vampires, I believe, as far as I can remember. Listener, you can correct me if I'm wrong, because somebody got the idea to revive the play. And again, lightning struck twice. They cast Frank Langella, and the play became a huge Broadway success. And because of that, Universal said, hey, don't we own this? It's like, we should make a remake of Dracula. So they cast the guy from the Broadway play again and made Dracula.
Is the whole cast from the Broadway play?
No, just Frank Langella. Just Frank Langella.
Because Laurence Olivier is Van Helsing.
Yes, in this?
Yeah.
But not, he wasn't in the play. I know,
that's what I was just, whatever. Yeah. You know, I was starting to talk about the movie.
The play was also, at the time, like, it was a thing because, do you know who Edward Gorey is, the artist?
Nay.
You ever see, you remember Mystery on Masterpiece Theater on PBS?
No.
Yes, vaguely. Okay,
the
yes.
opening of Crazy. That with yeah. the drawn, you know, it's, he was kind of like, not Charles Adams, but I mean, he'd be right. the other, he illustrated, I think they were like kind of little ghoulish
yeah.
Cartoons. But they got Edward Gorey to design the sets.
Edward Gorey, I have to look that up.
So the sets for this production all look like illustrations. Mm-hmm. And they had bat wings like worked into everything and into the costume design and mm-hmm. all that. And you can actually buy it on Amazon right now as a miniature thing, the Edward Gorey Dracula set.
Weird.
Yeah, it's kind of weird.
What are we talking about?
Dracula 1979.
That!
And the movie also came out because of this new interest in vampires. In 1979, you had Dracula, the big budget Universal movie. You had Nosferatu, the vampire, the Werner Herzog movie, and Love at First Bite, which beat them all, I think.
Oh, fuck yeah, dude. Love at First Bite. That's my Dracula movie. Children of the Night. Shut up. Classic.
Yeah. So this movie takes some liberties with the Dracula storyline. Significantly.
But that comes from the play, right?
Yes. Yeah. In the play, for some reason, they switch the characters of Lucy and Mina.
Just because I'm sure the person that wrote this original screenplay just didn't care to look originally. They're just like, what are their names? Okay, Lisa and Mina.
Right. You know? Well, oops. The thing that like I've always loved about, like, I mean, reading the novel Dracula and, you know, some of the early adaptations of it is the best scenes in that seem to be like the stuff that happens at the beginning where Jonathan Harker goes to the creepy castle and sits down and has dialogue with
that's Count like Dracula. The creepy part of Dracula.
Yeah.
The first scene when, or there's the there's supposed to be like the coach with the whatever, the dark coachman, whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
And then takes him to Castle Dracula, the like good evening and all that shit.
Yeah.
Then Harker becomes like slave to Dracula, like right away, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
But in this, I mean, because it makes sense. It's like, why the fuck would Jonathan Harker have to go all the way to England just be like, you want to buy this house? He's in England. He goes all the way to Transylvania
mm-hmm.
to sign a deed or whatever. Right. So it does make sense that Dracula would just come to where the house is to sign the deed, I guess. Plus, it does like, I don't know.
Well, I also wonder if there's. See, this is like a subtle thing that I'm not sure, but watching it tonight, I'm like, what year does this take place?
I was wondering that too, and I get really caught up in this. Every movie I watch is supposed to be a period piece, and to the point that like it takes me out of the movie, but like I was like, okay, those lights look like they're electric.
Yeah.
But their outfits they're wearing say something different. Like I get really caught up on that, and I could not tell you. Couldn't figure it out.
I mean, there's automobiles. So I gave up trying. So...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the first Dracula movie with a car chase.
Yeah.
It looks like it's from. It's got to be like I'm guessing 1910.
Yeah.
There's some like newsboys too. Totally.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah.
Evening, squire.
Yeah.
Well, I know that at one point Harker walks into a bedroom and flips a light switch and turns on
the
light. So I mean,
scares them, but then they settle.
Yeah, so that's why I wonder if, like, if the book took place in 1897, mm-hmm. if this one now moved into the 20th century, early 20th century.
Yeah.
So Dracula has
somehow... The book is 1897?
Yeah.
Really? Mm-hmm.
So maybe he's been communicating by, you know, like
telegram
or something.
Western Union.
Yeah, but it jettisons all that stuff that you like about, or that I like about Dracula. Yeah, throws it right that. Out the fucking window.
Even though he does find a castle just as creepy as his Transylvania castle in England.
So many goddamn cobwebs. You know, Holy shit, every square inch.
Jonathan Harker's like a lazy real estate dude or whatever. He's like, you fucking clean this place up, leave some cookies out or something.
Like cobwebs so dense you can't see through them. Like, they're opaque, they're so dirty, like...
Well, it's an abbey, right? Yeah. It still is Carfax Abbey, and like, thanks to the matte artist Albert Whitlock, the thing is like one of the great gothic silhouettes sitting on like an island. It looks like in the middle of it. But the interior of this place, I mean, aside from being completely covered by centuries, it looks like of cobwebs, has these weird bat faces,
dragons and shit
carved in,
like
all
someone's of, like just like. I like dragons.
Were you trying to at any point sit there and go like, what must this place have been like when it was an abbey for monks?
Right.
I assume.
Well, but that's where you find most like gargoyles and stuff.
I suppose.
That's the, it's the like scare away like evil spirits and shit.
But in the actual, what do you
probably
call
not it? Inside of it. No.
He's turned that into his dining room or whatever.
Whatever. I don't even know. Like, yeah, they built that one set and they're like, we're cool. Like, let's not build anything else. We got the ship. We got, like, what's the name of the ship? They don't even say the name of the ship, right? The famous name of the ship that I can't recall.
In the book, it's the Varna, I think. No, the Demeter.
The Demeter.
It leaves
right?
in Varna, right. There was supposed to be a movie at one point called The Last
Voyage of
the Demeter.
There's supposed to be comic books about... It's like, dude, that's always supposed to be the story, right? Like, what happens on the voyage from, like... No one knows. No one can figure it out. They're like, I don't know what does happen. It's not an exciting story, right? You know, like, Dracula's going to live. Everybody's going to die on it. You know, like.
Everybody dies on the voyage over. Yeah, but there's the movie there.
And this has, what, Lisa? Or what's her fucking
Lucy?
Name? Lucy. Jesus Christ. That's how much I know Dracula. But she finds, like, Dracula washed up on the.
Oh, that's Mina. Yeah.
Mina.
Yeah.
Because then this is switched.
Mm-hmm. They're pretty interchangeable in this movie, I think, though.
They kind of like, are. They're like, alike, they're brunette English girls.
Yeah.
Well, they've.
But in this, Lucy's very, like, she's already very sexual, right? This is why I'm like, this is like 1910. This is like nearing, like, women's voting time and shit, because she's very in this movie. She's like, shut up, John. You know, he's like, yes, okay. You know, I mean, she's not like.
I was going to say, you said very sexual, but I'm like, nothing compared to the 92, the Bram Stoker's Dracula version where she's.
Well, but I mean, sexual
quote,
as in
unquote,
like.
Entertaining three guys, you know, at the same time. And it's just like, she's.
Well, but me in this, Lucy, who is in this engaged to Jonathan Harker, right? Mm-hmm. Like, even in this, like, when they're having their party, they're, like, doing the tango or something. And this is how I'm like, oh, shit, she's, like, this very sexualized woman, right? And Jonathan Harker, they're these very modern, sexualized people. You know, that's...
Don't they call that liberated?
Well, but that's the but that's what Dracula's always been about, right? Liberation leads to infidelities and, like... whatnot.
It turns you into a monster. Yeah.
I'm a whore. Yeah, you're a whore, lady. That's what this whole thing's about. It's about how European dudes can turn your ladies into whores.
It's not unlike the movie Cat People, where, like, you know, you start exploring your sexuality, it turns you into a monster sort of thing. It's similar.
But I've always thought, and I don't know if this is my own, like, theory, but I've always thought Dracula specifically was about the foreign. You know, the foreign invader getting your woman, right? Like, you know.
Totally. I can see that.
Well, I mean, in the novel, it's like, it's still presented that way because I guess, you know, there's those scenes early on where it describes, like, you know, the women in Dracula's house, you know, go to their knee to, you know, bite Jonathan Harker, where it's like, you know, at that time, any woman who got on her knees
with
a man, like, you know, didn't come home to see mom for, you know, dinner.
What? She's smoking a cigarette? What a hussy.
Yeah. And Lucy, in the novel, whenever she becomes a vampire, is described in ways that, you know, accentuate the fact that she's full-blooded and, you know, very sexy, basically, you know, alluring, which she didn't have prior to being exposed to Dracula. So Dracula, like you said, right? He's the foreign guy who comes in.
He talks like this.
Changes, yeah. And he somehow sexually liberates all the women.
All of them.
Mm-hmm.
Although they're in the novel, see, it still seems like, I mean, this is like overt as hell. I guess like that's why.
There's no subtext in this movie.
Yeah.
It's all text.
Yeah. it's just all there. Text.
In any other prior that's kind of the problem, Dracula right? movie.
Once you like lose that like censorship, you have to just show it for what it is. And they're like, they're fucking, you know, like this is what we're talking about, folks. It's not well, just it biting the neck.
More explicit, like the further you go in time, you know, the later Dracula movies are, you know, I mean, you know, compared to Bram Stoker's Dracula, this is chaste, you know, but compared to even the Christopher Lee ones, because I remember like, you know, reading criticism about the Christopher Lee movies. They say that, you know, he's a magnetic lover, you know, of women in that those movies and women are attracted to him and all that. But you watch it and it's like I'm sitting there going like, well, he puts them in a thrall. You know, and they lean back on the bed and maybe like expose their, you know, throat to him or something like that. And that's really as far as it goes. But in this movie, I'm like, where's the Dracula before this where like he is like 100% like the Byronic lover, you know, character. I think even the tagline played up like he's the greatest lover who ever lived and died and lived again, you know, or whatever. But he is 100% like the guy who comes into the room, all the women are completely fawning over him, like throwing themselves at him. He's got to fight him off with a stick. And then it changes the motivation of our protagonists, right? From like, we have to stamp out this evil to like one guy's daughter has been killed by this guy or corrupted and then murdered. And then she dies. One guy's daughter is currently going through that process. And the other guy's girlfriend has been, you know, taken by Dracula. So it's all very personal to them, right?
Right.
Instead of like an altruistic, like it's evil and we have to kill it because it's evil. It's like, we got to get him because he's taking our women.
Yeah. Well, they kind of don't know at first, right? Because like Jonathan Harker, like what in this movie, she like dances with him. That's what symbolizes the scene of like, you know, and it, but it's, in this movie, I mean, it's Lucy that's doing the, like, dance with me. And that's what's crazy about this version of Dracula that I find. It's like, this is the woman's liberation version of Dracula where it's it's going to fuck me up when calling her. Like, the character's supposed to be Mina. Right, it's not supposed to be Lucy. It's fucking me up. But so Lucy is supposed to get, like, in the trance. But no, she's the one that's very open to Dracula. She is very inviting to him. And, you know, maybe it's that idea. I don't know. I was going to say,
Well, they kind of set that up early in the movie. I think the first scene where you're introduced to Mina and Lucy having a conversation, they're talking about how I think it sounds like Lucy has just gotten a job, unless she's so reading something like that's from Jonathan Harker, but it says you'll be a welcome addition to our law firm.
Yeah, it's a very like...
Yeah, so it's like, here's a... I mean, what do you want to say? Like enlightened, empowered, you know,
right.
feminine character.
The independent female. She's not part of Jonathan Harker. You know, like every Dracula story just treats Mina, Lucy, whatever the fuck you want to call her, as just Jonathan Harker's wife at home that's going to get seduced by the foreign guy. This actually treats her, this treats Jonathan Harker like the secondary character in a weird way. Because we do start on her. You know, like, at first, I didn't even think that was Jonathan Harker. I went like, well, I was like, well, this is interesting. Jonathan Harker must already be held captive at Castle Dra-. I didn't realize we were meeting the character Jonathan Harker. I was like, oh, fuck, this is a little different.
Yeah.
But then I was like, well, the guy's a fucking, he's a pussy. He even, like, barely has a mustache. Like, barely. I was like, you would shave that mustache. If that was your mustache, you would shave it.
He kind of took me out of the movie a lot because he looked like the 70s as a person. And like everybody else looked very period accurate except him. Like
and
he looked
Dracula's
like,
hair.
And Dracula's hair.
Dracula's
the Barry
hair.
Gibb hair. Yeah, but
he did have like a disco shirt too towards the end that was like cut down the middle like Disco Dracula. Oh, Disco Dracula. Copyright. Sorry, I appreciate it.
No, Jonathan looked like low rent Burt Reynolds for sure. Like... Ugh. Everybody else was so perfect, though.
But I get
like,
he was a very emasculated man. He wasn't like the Jonathan Harker that's gonna like stop Dracula or whatever. He was just like, Mina. He's like jealous in the corner, like when she's dancing with Dracula, like, and he's trying to be like, he's trying to seem like he's this like
But that's the thing, right? That's through the course of the movie. Yeah. It's like,
because that's the scene where Harker should be like, God damn it. No, you're not dancing with him. I mean, he's trying to make a deal. So he's letting, like, God damn. Like, this is why maybe I've never really liked the Dracula story. It's a very, like, paranoid with righteously so. Like, I hate the idea that you don't want to be paranoid, but then it's like, oh, fuck, but you should be paranoid. This lady's totally talking to Dracula.
Yeah,
behind your back.
Yeah.
And, like, that's what kills me about every vampire story is the chicks are just like, oh, fuck you. I'm going with the vampire. In the end, the guy goes out and fights for him. And you know the guy's going to stay with her. It's just like, this is sick, man. It's like the ultimate cuck. It'd be like your chick goes out and cheats on you. And you still like, whatever, baby. I'll still. It's just like, oh, it's kind of disgusting.
But the excuse here is that there's vampire magic at play.
Yeah. No, but the vampire magic is like, that's like the chick's excuse, right? Like, I imagine Bram, like, this is my imagination. Bram Stoker's wife cheated on him, right? And she just couldn't help the fact, you know, she's a stupid woman. She can't help what she did. So the guy's like, well, it's the animalistic allure of the foreign man or the whatever. That's just what I get out of Dracula every time I see it. I'm like, oh,
Bram Stoker's working out some.
Sure. Just like, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He's just like, what could I have done? She couldn't even do anything. The guy was rich and handsome. She had no power of her own.
But that's also in stark contrast to the book. In the book, Dracula is not described as like a handsome Lothario. He's a creature, this old guy, mm-hmm. who basically shows up and like forces Mina to drink his blood.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's not like, yeah, I mean, all that stuff about like a romance between Mina and Dracula, I think comes from the Jack Palance movie. Actually, so Jack Palance was Dracula in a TV movie from the 70s that was directed by Dan Curtis, who you may know as the creator of Dark Shadows.
Whoa.
But in that movie, I think vampires, huh? That was the, yeah.
Yeah, no kidding.
That was the
I got another idea. Yes. Okay. We know.
But I think that was the first time, if memory serves, that, you know, they worked in a subplot where Dracula had, and you've seen this in like hundreds of vampire stories since, the idea that Dracula had a great love when he was alive.
Oh, the
and
painting?
This woman looks just like his great love.
The reincarnated, like.
Yeah. So that turns him into, I guess humanizes the monster, right? Mm-hmm. And that gives him like this, you know, motive. It's like, I got to get my girlfriend back. Mm-hmm. Like, you know.
Makes him more of an anti-hero than a villain at that point.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Because, and that's the thing too about, you know, like Mina's position in the novel. It's like, even though she's living in the 1897, you know, time period, Stoker describes her as like, I mean, I guess his best compliment is that she has a man's brain. You know, it's like,
oh,
she,
yeah?
You know, yeah, he keeps on like, she is one of the vampire hunters, except she's also like, polluted by her exposure against her will. In that case, you know, she's got Dracula's blood in her. And that also gives them the whatever telepathic ability to track him down.
I think the thing I really liked about this movie is that like we didn't get a big long like B plot of one character trying to convince another that this was actually happening. Mm. That seems to be a trope in films now of like this paranormal whatever unexplained thing is happening and one character knows what's happening and the other doesn't, and the whole movie is character A trying to convince character B that no, this is actually happening, and then in the third act they finally realize it. Didn't have to deal with any of that in this movie, and I'm glad because I don't need to see that anymore.
Well, hasn't like because I'm the I, it's been a long time since I've seen the Bram Stoker's Dracula, but hasn't Dracula always just been like Van Helsing looks in a book and he's like vampires,
and
everyone's
like
I found it right here,
yeah.
Like under V.
Well, that's actually what bums me out about a good number of the more recent Draculas is like Van Helsing comes into it. Like already possessing, well, even in the 31 Dracula, it's like Edward Van Sloan's, he goes like vampirism. Like, you know, he already knows about it. I mean, the Anthony Hopkins Van Helsing is like, dude, you've been, he says something like, you're the foe I've been seeking all my life. You know, I mean, like he's been studying this kind of stuff. And so he goes to it right away. I like the Laurence Olivier portrayal because he's just like, I mean, he's like an old guy. And the fact that he is this old, frail cancer-ridden guy at this period in his time.
Right? He's not like this majestic, like, vampire hunter guy.
Yeah, they're up against a force that is more able-bodied than they are, these old guys, you know?
It's two old guys and a fucking weakling, Jonathan Harker.
Yeah.
Going Father, up against do something.
A guy who can turn into wolves, he can punch through walls, he can climb up the side.
You can hear him climb up the side. I could have almost done without the Renfield story in this. As you're talking about getting rid of the beast story, it's like, we don't even need Renfield in this fucking movie. I mean, it really was about just these like, hey, it would be fun to update this, like a modern update where it'd be like, hey, I'm like real estate guy. Like, I'm going to come have dinner with you. You know, like that would be fun.
Yeah. Well, Renfield's always like one of those characters that, you know, you end up. Well, I remember the TV version of Bram Stoker's Dracula, like, totally deleted the whole Renfield subplot. And you didn't even notice that it was gone. I mean, he's, like, basically the harbinger of, like, Dracula's coming! Dracula's coming!
I mean, I guess it's always supposed to, like, what, the character Renfield is supposed to symbolize what? Like, the idea that...
Something evil coming.
Yeah, I guess so. I always thought it was the whole, like, idea, like, I mean, the idea of Dracula, not that it necessarily centers around faith or anything like that, but as soon as Renfield is faced with something with immortality and it promises him any sort of power, you know, Renfield's just like, whatever, I'll do whatever you want, you know? Like, I always thought that's what his character was signifying, just kind of like the weakness of man, how we will, like, give up. Like, to any sort of, I mean, it's a stretch, because I've never really cared for the character of Renfield.
Yeah, I was never really sure, like, I mean, in
because, you know, okay, everybody Dracula comes across has that, he gives them that, like, hey, I'll let you, I mean, this is his pickup line, like, I'll let you live forever, I'll let you live forever, right? And you don't know if he's going to do it, you know? It's another one of the, like, cautionary, like, oh, beware the... promises of a false whatever.
But somehow Renfield actually has to live as a mortal person as kind of... See, I always thought, like, Renfield, is he like Dracula's protector?
He's the puppet. But, yeah.
But it's like that time has come and gone. He's mentally unstable. He's like from the lower class, you know, at least in this movie, right? It's like everybody else is high society. And he used to live in Carfax Abbey. And he's been booted. I think he was a squatter or something, right? And that's why he's pissed at Harker, because Harker sold the house.
Oh, and kicked Renfield out. Crazy.
So Renfield's just kind of working there for
Jesus
the
Christ. Was that this count. Movie?
Yeah. They And so then he just becomes like a bug-eating madman after
Dracula.
Bug-eating
madman. Because you got to suck on life, y'all.
Yeah, but I never really got that.
Because he's supposed to be...
In this one, the way I have in some of the other ones.
Because Oh, yeah, I guess so, right.
It's like, the blood is the life, and I have to consume all life. But in this one, he does it, but you're never really sure why.
There's no payoff for it. Like, it doesn't resolve anything or answer anything. That's right. For sure.
Like, and we don't even know. I mean, basically, it looks like it starts because...
I mean,
not
Renfield
so much
is just kind of where they
he's,
get...
like, hungry in the morning when he wakes up after the Dracula hangover. He's been bitten by a bat, and he eats a cockroach.
See, he's, like, at that half point, right? He's, like, the ghoulish... I mean, this movie... That's the problem with this movie, is they take out, like, kind of all the horror. So the parts that you should know is, like, oh, no, you know, Renfield is now, like, this, like, ghoul of a man because he was bitten and, like, you know...
Well, you say they took out the horror, but when I saw this, and I think this was maybe my first introduction to the character, so I was young, so you got to cut me some slack. But I remember a number of jump moments, which it's like interesting that they work those in. You know, somebody jumps out of a curtain at one point. I remember jumping, or, you know, there's loud noises and bangs and. But there's that scene that, you know, that takes place in the graveyard where they confront the undead Lucy. And even the way that they shoot it, it's like Steven Spielberg shoots stuff like this. You see like a shadow of something. Then you see a character's reaction to it. And then you cut to the slow pan up, you know, to this like undead corpse of Lucy. And it's like just creepy. I thought it was creepy as all hell.
It was,
I
mean, cool. It was a great scene. Yeah,
the great horror movie moment of this movie.
Because it's out of like nowhere in this movie. That's why. Mm-hmm. That's why it was effective. It's because like this movie, it doesn't do a lot to create this atmosphere of whatever. But then when you get down there, then she's just like, ah, it looks like. I mean, it kind of looks like a zombie from like Omega, the Omega Man. You know, like you're painted white. Yeah. You have some pieces glued to you, but hey, you know, it was like a zombie thing back then.
I liked the scope of this movie. I liked how like big everything felt, like the landscape shots, like the establishing shots, the way they shot everything. It felt big, and I feel like now in movies you don't ever get that.
You're always on a set.
It's always on a set, or it's always on a green screen. And if it is like. If they do spend the money on establishing shots, they use them over and over again to the point that it's redundant. Like, you know, like, we spent all this money in this aerial, better use it for everything. Yeah. You know,
there's some, like, shots that, you know, you can tell that, like, it's an Albert Whitlock painting only because they didn't have, you know, CG back then. But, like, you can see, like, a little town in the background. Yeah. Smoke coming out of a smokestack.
Yeah, a little too big. Like, I noticed that's, like, that was a big smokestack for it to be, like, way back there, dude. That's, like...
But it's cool.
But I'm glad they went for it. Like, for it. You know,
it looked
like,
good.
But they shoot, like, on the cliffs of wherever in the hell they shot.
That looked like Ireland. This was, it looked like parts of Ireland.
It was Shepparton, right?
Shepparton Studios. Yeah. But did they go to Whitby to actually shoot this? I don't know. Like, we see for brief moments in time, like, when they go down to Scarborough. The port at the end, like I was sitting there and like, did they go through and remove all the TV antennas or anything that would make that look modern for the entire sea facing part of that town? Mm-hmm. I was trying to think like where else they actually. The second unit on this movie is another thing where I think they get like some mileage out of it. There's a scene I think where like. After Dracula's attacked somebody, they show the city like waking up. And so they've got like all these, you know, kids on a coal cart and like people just kind of, and I'm like, who in the fuck spent the money to get all these extras together to just wander through like these, what looks like a real place? I guess maybe that's also what I kind of dig about this version of Dracula over some of the other ones is like, it looks like they spent money. They went to England. Right. They shot with English people on locations that looked like they could be real, you know, and opened the scope of it up, like you said.
That's the biggest issue, like, I think most people have with the 31 Dracula is that all the interesting things happen off screen for the most part. It's basically like they filmed a play for 31 Dracula. Like, it's not... they didn't expand on the play very much.
Right.
Whereas this one, like, they... Like, I gotta imagine the budget for this movie was insane. Because just, like... The location shots and the makeup and
all
the stunt animals alone. Mm-hmm. The stunt animals did some of the best work in this movie. Like, so many different types of animals. They all nailed it. And, like stuff that you could never do now. Those will all be CG animals. So, the budget for this movie in 70s dollars especially had to be a lot.
Yeah. I don't think it made it back, unfortunately. But I don't think it was a great hit. But I think, you know, I mean, as far as production value, I mean, even in the designs. Of everything. I mean, again, they're probably taking some, lead from the Gory, the Edward Gorey play. But, like, I noticed, like, Lucy, when she begins to become more vampiric, right? Mm-hmm. When she's in the, I think she's on her way to see Dracula and she's running away from the guys. She's got this collar that has, like, all these bat wing designs in it.
Mm-hmm.
When she's in the cell, because awesome. That's what you do when, you know, your woman's turning into a vampire. You lock her in a
well,
insane
her
cell.
Dad did that, right?
She's got these bat wings.
That was awesome. Yeah. That dress looked like it was from the fucking 30s, mm-hmm. you know? I was like, that's a cool touch, her in that white dress.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She becomes more bat-like. I guess that's the thing, like, this movie does is
she
constantly reinforces... The bats. Idea that the bats, yeah.
Because mm-hmm.
even Frank Langella
really
uses like two fingers all the time, right?
He's always. That's like his.
I think when he's holding
totally
on to
that's how he's. That's how you know he's using his like his hypnosis when he's not doing the look at the Maya, you know, whatever.
They shot him with a lot of Dutch angles too. Like, I noticed that, too. Lots of Dutch angles in Frank Langella. I don't know if that's because, like, ooh, something's off here. Mm-hmm. Can you tell by how the camera's tilted? Like, but, yeah, there were lots of Dutch angles on him.
So what do you guys think? Frank Langella, is he? I don't know. I don't know if he had that Dracula, like...
I think he does it for me. I think, like, I mean, my criteria is probably, like, high cheekbones, like, severe eyes. And, I mean, his widow's peak was insane. It was, like, 3 inches deep. But, like, the hairpiece is what killed it for me a little bit.
Maybe if he had that shit combed down a little bit. It's like, he's a big-haired Dracula.
But dude, his performance was fine, I thought.
Well, he has, like, there's a... what would you say it? Like, I just remember what's coming to my mind is a Roger Ebert review of this movie where he says, like, Frank Langella stalks through every scene like a cat, you know?
Oh, yeah.
He's got that kind of, like, everything is a very, I mean, obviously he played the thing on stage for God knows how many performances over the 2 years, you know, leading up to this. So everything's very mannered about the way that he does everything. Like, it's very, you know, pushing off of the fireplace and turning around.
It's just sexual, right? It's just this very, it's a super sexualized Dracula, right? Where they're, you know.
He's very smooth.
It basically got a chick saying, like, no, and he's just like, oh, yeah, we'll talk about that.
It's like everything he does is calculated. Everything is like advancing him. Yeah, in his performance. I think his performance is like, everything he does is to advance the character. The character already knows how it's all going to play out. Mm-hmm. And this is all just steps to that.
Because it's uber confidence. It's like nobody can kill him. He's going to fuck all the ladies.
Right.
It's just uber confidence. Oh,
it's
like,
that scene where he invites Lucy and her dad to the dinner.
Yes.
Like, you're invited, of course, but you'll be out of town. It's like, what a dick.
Right. It was great. Dracula burn.
Yeah. I guess
I hate that guy.
The issue that I usually have, like, you know, when I go back to revisit this movie is, like, you know, I mean, what I want from a vampire, I guess, has evolved over time. So you go back and you're like, okay, well, first of all, I don't see him, like, commanding hordes of, you know, an army. Like, he's the last of his kind, this warlike race, you know, and I'm like, Frank Langella? And then, you know, there's also I don't see him, like, sleeping in the dirt because he wakes up and this Dracula.
He's beautiful.
He's clean.
Yeah. And this is another thing where it's like, wow, this movie is really making a departure because he fits in with high society, high English society. This foreign guy from a land who doesn't have an accent, you know, right? Comes from Transylvania and can adopt into English custom. And it's like, okay, so, I mean, again, this isn't going off the book. It's just, you know, this is what the movie is telling us. So we don't know that he's been living in a castle by himself for 400 years, right? That doesn't necessarily apply to this character. But I can't reconcile that, like, this guy's been living alone, creeping around inside a castle in Transylvania and now wants to move to England. It's like, this guy lived in high society as a vampire in Transylvania and comes to England and can integrate directly. I mean, he goes to dinner.
Right.
The first night he's in town, it's like, invite him over for dinner. And we have a table, you know, conversation with Dracula.
But that's why it makes sense that Jonathan Harker is the realtor. That's like, that's the thing. Since it's a business deal, that changes, that, like, excuses almost why you would, you know, that idea that you're talking about, like, just the fact that there's a deal going on, like, gets you into people's houses. It gets you into, like...
Well, I get that, but I guess I can't reconcile that this guy is, like, some undead corpse, you know, like, creeping around graveyards and turning young maidens into vampires and stuff like that, because, like, this guy is a suave, social animal, you know what I mean? I mean, they say, you know, he's a count, so he's royalty. But, you know, it's like...
You don't think Bela Lugosi was that guy?
You know, you're absolutely right. Bela Lugosi is the same. Yeah. Yeah.
He's just a suave dude.
Yeah.
See, that's my problem with Dracula in a nutshell. I like vampires. I never like Dracula because Dracula's sexy. He's not scary. He's just sexy. That's all he is.
Well, he's scary because he's going to take your women, Travis. Well,
yeah.
What does it say on the poster there? It's like,
but it's not scary.
What's the tagline? It's like, throughout history, he has filled
the hearts of men with terror and the hearts of women with desire.
With desire. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. That's why I'm not even scared of it, because it's like every fucking woman likes him no matter what. If Dracula comes in your house, you're screwed. just say, all right, I'll see you tomorrow.
That's terrifying.
Honey.
What are you talking about?
That is terrifying. That's horror. That is terrifying. But it's not like, I don't know. I guess that's, I don't know. I don't know what that is. Mm.
So as much as I love Donald Pleasance, like, he's great. He, like, I expected him to be bouncing off the walls way more in this movie. Like, he seemed kind of sedated for Donald Pleasance. Like, he kind of took a back seat.
I was like, he's like a man of science in this fucking movie. Yeah. He's just like, well.
Whatever you say.
Madness. Crazy. Yeah. Vampires.
He only has one scene where he gets real crazy when she can't breathe in the bed. And he's like slapping the shit out of her and everything. But, like, I expected that to, like, him to be at 11 for the whole movie. Because that's usually how he does things. But... He's a little dialed back in this
stand the insane asylum. That was like a cartoon. This whole movie is like this really serious down to earth. As soon as you go to the insane asylum, it's just, people just like, what the fuck? How is this any sort of institution?
Well, it's like bedlam, right?
They just let people running around screaming.
It reminded me of in The Dark Knight Rises, the prison that Bane puts Batman in. Yeah. Like, where everyone's just hanging out, just chilling. Just hanging out. Seeing the asylum, run around, do what you want.
Hey, just have a baby. That was the good Christian thing to do. Let an insane person take care of their own baby in the asylum.
I want to know what the logic was behind, like, the set design for the insane asylum. Because, like, those bridges that kind of came and that met in the middle. Because, like, it took me so long to figure out that was an insane asylum. At first I was like, wait, is this the inside of that boat? And then I was like, oh, okay, no, the boat wrecked and we're still seeing this, so no. Straitjackets are what put it together for me. But, like, but I was like, why have these weird, like, wire metal bridges that meet in the middle in, like, this circle, like, that prisoners are apparently always running around on? Because every scene in the movie, they're just running around. They're like,
you only get locked up if you're violent, I think. Yeah. Otherwise, they're just allowed to mingle. There doesn't seem to be much of, like, a therapy going on. No. It's just, this is containment.
And there's, like, two employees putting him on drugs.
I did like that like, funny joke that, you know, Van Helsing goes to Donald Pleasance, is like, well, did you put Lucy on whatever?
Laudanum.
Laudanum. And it was like, oh, my daughter? God, no. Or whatever. Yeah, I thought that was a good joke.
Treat your daughter with it. Yeah. Donald Pleasance is like the comic relief. I mean, like, it's not,
a great part.
Well, no. It's not a barrel of laughs. Well, that's the thing, I think, where like, an actor like Donald Pleasance goes into this, says, I don't think this is, like, necessarily a great part. So it's like, well, what can I do to make my part more important? And he says, can you give me a bag of candies to just be munching on all the fucking time? Every goddamn scene that you see this guy, he's like chewing stuff.
He's eating
like in every scene. Swear to God,
that's true.
He's wandering around chewing.
It had to be a character choice. There's no way that was scripted that way. That was totally him being like, guys, I have an idea.
Yeah. Let's add something to the
part. His only role is to console his daughter. That's his only role, is to be like, everything's fine, it's fine, don't worry about it, it's cool. That's all he does.
That kind of seems to be a trend of people that have a really successful movie, though, that kind of puts them on the map. Like, usually the next movie they do after is not that great. Like, it just seems to be a normal trajectory for actors. So,
it's a bigger paycheck.
Anyway. Yeah, and at that point. Yeah, exactly. And not that this was, like, terrible for him by any means, but, like, if you watch Halloween or Psycho or anything, like, this is not what you expect from him. Not at all. Like, you don't expect him to be like a C-level character in a movie.
I've seen a lot of Donald Pleasant stuff over the years, where it's like,
you
went from
this.
Halloween, where you were basically the biggest name in that thing, to third being in Dracula.
Yeah, it seems like you're just back in Amicus movies or something like that, you know, like,
with a bigger budget this time.
That's what is weird about this movie, is like, fuck, it's like, I almost, like, wish it was more Americanized. I don't know why. I do feel like it was, like, I don't know. Yeah, very British.
I'm curious.
And I guess it should be. But, I don't know. I guess,
story,
I don't know.
I suppose. How does vampirism work in this movie? This is one of those things that I'm not entirely...
You have to bite somebody and then give them your blood.
They play kind of fast and loose with it, so I honestly couldn't tell you.
Well...
there's a few established rules, but...
Well, I'm just using
mirror, garlic.
Mina as the case study here, right?
Okay.
Mina is bitten by Dracula. She dies of asphyxiation, pain in her throat. She complains she can't breathe. She dies. She's buried. She comes back to life as a undead specter, looking like, you know, she just crawled out of the grave.
She eats the baby.
And eats a baby. Van Helsing and
Seward kill her?
Stake her. Mm-hmm. And then They dig her up or bring her to, you know, whatever, prepare the body. And she has magically regained a look that looks alive, as Van Helsing mm-hmm. says. And at this point, Van Helsing brings out the mirror and shows that Lucy or Mina is not there and says, I have to take out her heart. My question is now at that point in time, now that they've staked her the first time and killed the undead version of her, and somehow she's magically like now restored, is she more like Dracula on her second, after her second death?
I don't know.
Like, is that the thing
you have? I was confused about that the whole time. I was like, why isn't she dead?
Right.
Didn't they stake her?
Yeah. Right.
Like, what?
Right.
Is that, does it do that in the book?
No.
You stake them in the book. These people don't know what vampires are. They think you kill the dead version and the undead version.
Yeah.
It's like they filmed this movie with her getting staked and dying, and we're like, shit, we only hit 80 minutes. Fuck, we got to write some more of this movie, guys. We got to hit like at least 90 minutes.
Well, I mean, idea that they have to 149 minutes.
Short.
But the idea that, you know, you have to, you know, tear out the heart, cut off the head, stuff the head with garlic mm-hmm. and burn the heart, right? All that's from the book. But in this one, it's like, well, we still have to do somehow to conclusively, like, she's dead. They staked her, right?
They say, well, she's undead, just like Dracula. Mm-hmm. You know, they say she's undead. So I don't know what the fuck the previous staking is about. I just don't know that.
Yeah, not entirely sure on that myself.
No, it's stupid.
And coming back to a point that you were making before, I think about how the women relate to Dracula, the thrall, the vampiric thrall that he has. It's like, how much free will? Because he says, like, you know, in his time, he's had many brides, and he's going to put Lucy above them all. Mm-hmm. I'm not entirely sure what he sees in her that he hasn't seen in countless other women throughout history.
That's just a lie. He's just saying that to the chick, so she'll be like, cool.
He's not saying that to the chick, though. He's saying that to her fiance. She's not even in the room.
Oh,
so
yeah?
He means it. It's a legitimate thing to him.
Unless
he's just fucking with
he's
Jonathan
He's just
Harker.
Whatever, man. He's just like, dude, pretty soon she'll become one of those brides. Like, it's just...
Well, he says that they're going to go to another, you know, eventually when she becomes full vampire, they're going to go to another plane. They're
it's
make
just
more.
The threat of taking her from him. That's all that matters. Hmm. It's not about what Dracula is gonna like.
Yeah,
I love her.
I don't see the end game in that statement. So
he's just know. You know
get together yeah. and make little right. baby vampires.
She's basically just saying in a weird way. I mean, it's not. I guess today you would be like she likes me more, but back then you'd just be like, you know, I'm going to treat her better than anything. You know, like because of course she'll be with me. I'm gonna provide for her better than anybody ever, and we're gonna live forever.
But
that's why chicks will always go for Dracula.
But
guys,
but
we're in trouble.
What I'm concerned about is that even though she is in his, you know, in love with him, right? I mean, she's obviously attracted to him. She goes out to dinner with him.
That's the big bitch of it.
She lets him put the bite on her, you know. Then once that happens, it's like, okay. So there's that scene where he takes her to his castle. And he goes to prepare the coffin, and he's like, Lucy. And for a minute, she stands there, and she doesn't immediately, like, run to him. And I'm sitting there going, like, is that, like, there's still some human part of her that is not entirely within his control yet? In which case, like, does she actually, like, love this guy? Or is she only doing his beck and call?
No, she loves him. She just feels guilty that she had to fuck over people that she also, like... People don't feel bad. I mean, they only feel bad that they have to fuck over people. They don't feel bad what they get out of fucking over people. They just feel bad that they got to do it. Yeah. Oh, God damn it, Dracula. I hate him.
Well, I mean, you know, when I was a kid, I wanted to be him. I guess that was
the
thing.
Of course.
It's like, because you walk into a room and every woman is like,
I'll tell you what, go to Asia. white dudes are Dracula in Asia.
fantastic.
Tall white guy, Dracula. Oh, shit.
Well, this movie ends differently than than any Dracula story before. I mean, obviously, the 31 Dracula... They kill Dracula off screen. I mean, it's very anticlimactic. Nothing happens in the end of that movie. So for the remake, they're like, God damn it, we're going to have an ending to this. It's going to be on the quality of the caliber of the French Connection or something. We're going to have a chase scene
in a Dracula movie. It's like Benny Hill sped up.
I want to put some wacky sex to that. Cut it with the Benny Hill wacky sex.
Well, to be fair, it does have, we forgot to mention this, the majestic score of Sir John Williams.
It does have. There's like one score. Dude, yeah, there's one part. And I was like, this would be like a Dracula musical. He's got the tune right here. Like, just got to come up with some fucking words.
Wait, did we talk about the, really quickly, the Dracula laser light fog machine love scene set to the
score?
That went on way longer than I thought it was going to.
Yeah.
Why all the superimposed bats?
It looks like a James Bond like title sequence.
It really
was. It was designed by the guy who did it. Morris Jarre, or whatever.
But that's when there should have been like,
he has one style of doing things.
Oh, where's the Dracula Bond theme for this movie? That's where Dracula, the love theme from
It seemed like they shot like a minute of it and then just looped it again, though. Like, it didn't seem like they shot a full scene of it. It's like they looped it to finish it out.
It's ridiculous.
Big red clouds explode around them. But it reminded me somehow, for some strange reason, of Superman the movie, where you had that long, like, the Lois Lane song. You know where she's singing? What's the name of the fucking song?
Do you read? Can you read my mind?
Yeah, in the middle in the middle of your big epic movie, set to John Williams' music, you have like, you know, this interlude where, you know,
there should have been a Dracula like a Dracula poem.
Oh, but it should have been disco.
Well, did you know it should have been disco? Dracula.
Should have had the Bee Gees write the soundtrack for the movie. Been
like, well, there's always love at first bite. So,
yeah.
And old Dracula with David Niven. Oh, God, I've seen so many Dracula movies.
I hate Dracula.
So this movie ends after the chase scene on a boat where Lucy is freed from the grip of... Well, actually, it's interesting again.
No, she's not. Not until he dies.
Well, Jonathan Harker...
She's still not.
This is his big moment, right? That we've been working for toward the entire movie. This is where Jonathan Harker is going to assert himself and win back his love from Dracula. Right? From the other guy.
Just
from
like his killing adversary. The other guy. How would you feel if, like, your wife left you, and then the only way you can get her back is just by killing the other guy? She's like, okay.
Well, this is drama.
I'll come back,
right?
Then.
In drama, you're raising the stakes, because it feels like that in real life.
I just
life,
feel you, like, you know, God damn it.
So, but this is my point. The point is that he doesn't kill Dracula. Van Helsing does.
Yeah.
Okay, there's a technicality there.
He's a pussy in this movie. This is an emasculated Jonathan Harker because Lucy is the masculine character in this. She's the one that's taking, like, hold of the situation.
Because she's a plot driver, at least until a certain point where then Dracula becomes... I mean, he is the ultimate...
Well, she's the plot, but she's also the one that, like, I don't know, she tells Jonathan Harker what the fuck to do. Jonathan Harker's a cuck in this fucking movie. It's really sad, dude. Really sad.
And he can't even kill Dracula. The only thing, Van Helsing, an old decrepit man, is the one who puts the hoist.
Was kind of stupid.
While he's dying.
Right. So he's dying, impaled. Dracula impales him on the wall, and he's able to throw this hook into the back of Dracula.
Well, but Jonathan Harker is, like, diverting him. He's fighting Harker. Right?
But, like...
He's about to get his head broken.
Van Helsing has a fucking pull through his torso, still does that. Like, he still pulls that off.
Well, I don't even think you could, like, just angle a little hook and slide it on a thing and have it go through anybody.
I saw it happen.
Yeah, in a horror movie. Because somehow pushing something at, like, the speed of, like, I don't even know...
Yeah, it's the pulley system.
It's stupid.
It makes it stronger.
I thought that part was so weak. I was like, what the fuck? Really? He, like, throws a hook in his back?
Yeah.
That shouldn't even do anything. Well, no, he does. I mean, he's going to take it out, but then he gets hoisted up.
Yeah, so that's what Jonathan Harker does. That's his contribution to this. Aside from fighting off Vampire
Lucy, him up.
Is he throws a switch that hoists Dracula into the daylight, where Dracula is powerless against the giant fireball rays.
I still think he gets away. That movie does nothing to me to say that was just his cape. I think he gets away because Lucy. It's a fucking bullshit.
I think Lucy, he gets away too.
Lucy is smiling. Oh, that's what I'm talking
it's a
about.
Secret smile. Well, it gives
it's
us
not a secret smile.
I think it gives us a satisfactory, at least to me. I don't
Parker's
know,
just ignoring
ending
it.
where Dracula is defeated. He gets hoisted up, and there's that beat where an old man, you know, burned Dracula, is spinning around on the hook. And then it's like, okay, it's all over. And everybody's like, whoo. And Lucy is returned what appears to be to her senses again without the
her
the
eyes crawl. Just aren't red or whatever.
Right. And then you hear this flutter and the Dracula cape or kite starts flying kite. Away over the and she has this the camera. I think that's the last shot, right? Mm-hmm. Is the camera closing in on her face and she has that's a so, smile to herself. That he's still
that's
alive.
Almost she's more frightening than Dracula in this movie. She is. Oh, god damn it. That's so rough.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, that's rough. I don't know, man. God well, forbid any of you chase after a woman that is just like, whatever, you know, this guy's totally got like nice, thick black hair, olive skin, like super rich. Oh, you killed him? I guess so.
What
I guess I'll just
us?
Do what I was doing before. Fucking you. Ah, so horrible.
Does that bring us to the end of Dracula 1979?
Yeah, I think so, right?
All right. We'll stick with this as we summon Igor our mailman. Igor, where are you, sir?
Masters, the mail. I've got the mail. So many letters. Our followers are rising.
Why, thank you, Igor.
Yeah, he's been working on his olive skin.
This is just a reminder that you can get a hold of us through Facebook at facebook.com/Saturday Night Freak Show. You can also reach us on Twitter. We're there as well. We're at Sat Freak Show. Or you can email us at SaturdayNightFreakShow@yahoo.com. And hey, when you're on any of those services, why don't you go ahead and give us a like or a star rating.
Share us or,
yeah,
or tell a friend.
Right, why not? It helps us expand.
Just make them listen to it in the same room as you.
That's my, the record.
Looking
that's how
at
I do
them
it.
Directly in the eye. Yeah, you just trap and be like, hey, we want to come over. And then when they get there, be like, we're going to listen to this. And like, oh, fuck. Just make them do it.
All right, so writing in tonight, Damian Prowse writes in, and Frank says Frank
you,
Langella
Damian.
Is the sexiest Dracula ever.
He's sexy.
Jacob Laws writes in and says, Gary Oldman is my favorite Dracula. He was very scary when I saw his Dracula at the age of 6.
Oh, God. Yeah, that movie at 6. Be rough.
Yeah. I thought he was a scary Dracula. Yeah. When he, like, licks that, the straight razor.
Oh, yeah.
Very scary.
Yeah. And Babette Georgie, writes in and says Christopher Lee is her favorite Dracula. So there you go. You guys got another favorite Dracula? Or another Dracula that stacks up somehow?
No.
I do kind of like the Klaus Kinski Nosferatu.
Werner Herzog guy?
Yeah.
He was cool looking.
But is he Dracula? He's called Dracula in the movie, so.
He's not Count Orlok?
No, not in the remake.
Really?
They actually
they had to pay for
public
yeah.
domain now. So.
Crazy, though.
Yeah.
Anywho, yeah, I don't think I have a... That dude from Love at First Bite, what's his name?
George Hamilton.
Oh, my God, yeah.
And you haven't seen the Jack Palance one yet.
No, I want to, because I think Jack Palance would be a great Dracula. He just seems very, like, very Dracula.
Well, there was also the Louis Jordan version... You remember him? You know who he is?
No.
Swamp Thing? He was Arcane in Swamp Thing?
Oh, no shit.
He was an octopussy. He was the bad guy.
No shit.
Yeah,
he's a Dracula?
Because he did it on stage what? After, I think he did, or Raul Julia did Dracula on stage after
really?
Frank Langella yep. left. And
crazy.
Did movie.
Too bad we didn't get a movie with Raul
yeah,
Julia.
Right?
That would have been awesome.
That would have been fucking
there's a picture
cool.
of him in this yeah. book, I think, as mm-hmm. the as Dracula. But yeah, Louis Jordan did a two-part miniseries for BBC called Count Dracula, which tried to do it as close to the book
dude,
as it could.
I gotta see that.
It's really rough.
Ah, but he'd be a good Dracula. Or I don't know. He was a good mad scientist for Swamp Thing. I think he'd be a good bad guy. I could watch a crappy movie. He's got a good bad guy.
I'm just not entirely sure that he's awake the entire time he's playing
well,
Dracula.
Well, they're on coke, right? Or What, it was the 70s down. Or like, what are we doing, Dracula? Okay. So are we, is that the it for the letters? Are we?
Yeah. So now I guess you hear that bell tolling off there in the distance. Shit.
The hour has come, sirs.
All right, so that's our Jesus butler Christ. Lurk. Thank you, Lurk. So that means it's time for wrap-ups. You know what that means.
This means it's my turn for wrap-ups.
We're going to start with Travis to go around the room. What'd you think of Dracula? And hey, stay tuned because the top 10 list is coming up after these.
I don't like any version of Dracula. I just don't. I've never liked the story of Dracula. Nothing really happens in it except for, like, I'm going to buy a house. I get trapped in a basement with three ladies. I go over and seduce Mina. I kill Lucy. I just always thought it was so fucking boring. I've always liked vampires as a creature, as a monster. But Dracula as a character, like I said, has always been too sexy and been too, like... And I've never seen any version that's made me think otherwise. So, yeah, like... I mean, this is no different than any Dracula movie. I hate all Dracula movies. I mean, if it's vampires, I'd rather watch Fright Night or Lost Boys.
What the hell?
Fright Night is Rear Window with a vampire. It is not Dracula.
It hit Dracula. I mean, come on.
Shut up.
I feel like those are in a different league. Like, they're
may
not
as
even,
well be. Yeah.
It's got fun music. This movie is so fucking dry. I was like, I almost forgot John Williams was doing a score to this movie in a few parts. Because I was like, where's the fucking music? I need something else going on in this movie besides people just like looking at wrecked boats and like, I don't know. There's just something about Dracula that's never, I don't know. And I don't know if it is the uncomfortableness, because I'm very aware of my uncomfortableness with stories about women that want to, like, leave you. And, like, that's a scary story to me. Like, watch A Simple Plan, directed by Sam Raimi. That story's always unnerved me. The fact that, like, this fucking chick is going to leave you, and you're still loving her? Oh, this is sad. I feel bad for the guy. I don't know. This movie, yeah, it just doesn't do it for me. Just like no other Dracula movies. My brother locked me in a room and made me watch vampire movies for like 10 years. So I have a disdain for vampires. So I need super
trauma. It always comes down to that. Uh-huh.
I need super cool vampire movies for me to really get behind the monster. But like I just hate Dracula. It's such a love story, or it feels like a love story. They're directed like love stories. You know, I'd rather have the monster version. You know, I'd rather have the Jonathan Harker's like perspective.
You gotta see any Christopher Lee one. Like any Christopher Lee, he's the monster.
Yeah, but that's stuffy 70s, like we turned all the lights on. You know, there's no atmosphere in Hammer movies. I don't like vampire movies. I'm sorry if that's like my one like thing as a horror fan. It's like I just kinda don't like a lot of vampire movies. A lot of them are just sexual. And it's like, scary. Like, I get it. I like sex. I like boobs in movies, but like, I can get that anywhere. I don't need to watch a fucking vampire movie. And like, didn't the cape look stupid in this movie, right? Like,
it had bat wings.
But the Count Dracula.
I was so distracted by the hairpiece that I didn't even notice the cape.
I just thought the big, like, collared Dracula cape in this movie was just like, they went with that? Like, it looks like a Halloween prop at this point. Like, the production design was so good for this movie. I just didn't see, like, it's like, I don't think that's ever been a real cape design, you know?
I thought the way he had his, like, neck covered all the time was, like, a weird subconscious way of, like, projecting onto other people, you know? Like, his neck was constantly covered. I was like, that's an interesting choice.
Mm-hmm. Frank, great Skeletor. Great Skeletor. I just don't care for tracking the movies. It's not its fault or your fault for making me watch it.
I actually really enjoyed it. Like, as far as Dracula movies go, obviously 31 Bela Lugosi Dracula is number one. This is a very close number two, though, above the Christopher Lee Hammer movies. I think, like, as far as Universal Monsters go, Dracula is not my favorite. But even still, this movie I thought was pretty enjoyable. And actually, for being made in 79, holds up really well. Special effects-wise, story-wise, it holds up pretty well. It doesn't feel like a movie that's as old as it is. I think it's enjoyable. I think that there's definitely some good things here, good storytelling. Like I said, my biggest disappointment was that Donald Pleasance wasn't as Donald Pleasance as he usually is, you know? Like, he could have turned it up a little more. Like if there's a movie to be ridiculous in, this is the one. Go full ham, man. You know? Like, why are you holding back?
This movie took itself so seriously. Yeah, dude.
Yeah, why are you holding back in this movie, of all things, to hold back in? Yeah, no, I would definitely recommend it.
He's gone with her.
Or even, like, if he would have done something to, like, when he's wearing his top hat, he's really straight-laced, but when he takes it off, he loses it. That would have been great. But I would give it, like, 3 out of 5 Barry Gibb hair pieces.
Sean's not here, but you're carrying on a tradition. Awesome.
Dom Krieg, yeah.
So I think maybe this is my favorite Dracula, but it's like, how much of that is based on the fact that it's the first exposure to the character that I had, right? I mean, like, that's a hard, because in the, I don't know if Dracula is my favorite Universal monster, but at some point, you know, he obviously was. I mean, I'm sitting here, I've got the play sitting on the bar. I've got the poster of this movie, like, in my basement. You know, I've had like every version of this thing that's come out. I've got like Dracula movies, you know, I'm in my library, you know, from 1931, all the Universal one. I mean, like, yeah, I've seen a lot of Dracula over the time. So clearly there is an appeal to the character and vampires in general. It's interesting to me that like vampires have kind of gone through this change that, you know, I mean, if Bela Lugosi set the template, you know, I suppose then the play, you know, started it, is the vampire, the 20th century American or, you know, Western vampire is a guy in a cape and a tuxedo, right? Who comes from the outside and arrives and steals your women, right? That stereotype or that basic structure started in 1928 to 31. Stuck with us until, I mean, it almost feels like Fright Night is like the end of that cycle. Like in the meantime, it's like there was all these gothic horror movies, you know, I mean, you even look at like when they try to update it, bring it into the modern day, like Salem's Lot or Count Yorga or Blackula or something like that, where a vampire or Dracula 1972, it's like they're still basically the Dracula prototype, right? But Fright Night was the first, or it was the last of the gothic, where it's like, you know, the gothic house is somehow next door to you in suburbia, you know, which is, you know, the contemporary thing. And you, it's like, now it's old hat. It's on TV on the Peter Vincent show or whatever. And like vampires in the real world. And from that moment on in 1985, granted Martin is ahead of its time in the '70s, but from that moment on, it's like, then the next stage is, well, like, well, being a vampire isn't so bad as long as we turn you back before the, you know, the moon or the next full moon or whatever the, you know, whatever the next day, or if we kill the head vampire, we can still rescue you or give you a blood transfusion or whatever, right? But you get to vicariously be a vampire for a little while.
You get to have the sexual prowess. You don't get threatened by the person with the, you get to be the invader. You get to experience
what it's like, but oh, there's a price to it and I don't want to pay the price, I gotta come back. And then the further expansion of that is, I guess, what was started in the 70s with the Interview with the Vampire, but, you know, and through Underworld and like all the, you know, things that have spun off of that, it feels like, and the Vampire the Masquerade game. But now it's like, now in Blade, there's a society of vampires where everyone's a vampire. We've all got this superpower and we can, you know, are these superpowers and this hierarchy and political stuff going back and forth. And it's like, well, you know, where do you go from there? Now, then you've got Twilight where like the girl's in love with the, you know, it's like, eh. So I like the gothic stuff. You know, that's the stuff that resonates and appeals to me the most. And this movie has a gothic flavor to it, an atmosphere. I mean, it's got the, you know, they go into the graveyard. Graveyard's got fog all over the fucking place. Yeah, these little headstones all over. I mean, you know, the castles are full of crap, moldy, dark, dank. You know, there's
because it's something that doesn't exist in America, Right. That's an English idea.
But gothic. I mean, like, it just has, it's the most gothic Dracula, like realistic gothic Dracula of them all, I think. It is a disappointment that, you know, we were talking during the movie, but I don't think we brought it up on the podcast, that when this movie came out, it was in vibrant Technicolor. And sometime in the 1990s, when they made a widescreen version of it for TVs, the director went and dialed down all the color, because that's what you did in the 90s. Seven was a big thing back then, right? And, you know, the look at the two towers in the 2000s. It was like, we got to just drain the color out of everything. So they desaturated the shit out of it. So now, if you have seen Dracula and you're under a certain age, you have never seen it the way that it would, that I remember seeing it on its broadcast run. You know, because, I mean, I remember those vampire eyes were bright red contacts with fiery red lights in the middle of them. And
they're,
that's
almost
like
black.
Yeah.
In this. Yeah. It's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, we'll post some screen comparison shots on Facebook this week so you can check it out. But I think, you know, there's really a disservice been done to this movie that, you know, hey, we'd like to see it in color again. But
sons of bitches.
And I think, you know, is.
Where are you, Screen Factory?
Right. And is Langella my favorite Dracula? I don't know if that, again, I think, you know, like Gary Oldman's Dracula and Bela Lugosi's Dracula have more of that like foreign element to it. I think, you know, it's like Langella's character is too, like, too smooth to be like a real predatory vamp, you know, undead creature, right? He's not a monster in the traditional sense where those guys feel like they are a little more. But what he is I think, like what Travis is saying, he's a sexual rival, a threat. And in that way, you know, he's scary, I guess, you know, as the idea, the concept of like what he's come here to do, you know, and disrupt the society that you're living in. So, so I don't know. He's definitely in the probably top two Draculas. I can't make a decision, but I'm going to go. Yeah, I would definitely recommend.
I'll tell you who the
movie.
Worst Dracula is, the Monster Squad Dracula or the Seven Brothers versus Dracula.
I got you beat. It's the Van Helsing Dracula. Ooh. Richard Roxbury, like, he is fucking awful.
Maybe.
Awful. But you know what? Actually, you know, that was the last. Oh, sorry. Universal Studios, right? And their Universal Monsters. They did Dracula, the remake of Dracula, Van Helsing, and Dracula Untold. That's
Dracula Untold. That's their sexy Dracula.
For how many times they've,
you know, I like the Dracula character from Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
I remember him.
Remember that episode? Gaunt,
looking long haired.
He
dude.
Also, that same actor also played in a Vlad Zepes movie.
Of course.
Isn't that crazy? Well, he looked. That's the only thing that actor could do is like, you're Dracula for a year. You'll be Dracula this year.
Yeah.
Moving on.
So I would recommend it. So that brings us to
Colin's horror picks.
I promised you I'd do this. All right. So my top 10 favorite horror movies of all time. You know how hard it is to put this list together?
Yes, I do. I made three of them. Three lists. I can give you the list at any time.
No, I was on, this is, I think, in my third. And so I'm going to say that this is, I mean, the only way I can qualify it is this is my list for today. And tomorrow may be a completely different list.
But is this the list of the movies you frequently watch? Or is this your,
yes,
the most, like.
Okay. No, these are, I think that's why I put them down as favorites, is because they are the ones that go in the machine the most, it feels like. So, all right. We're going to go with number 10.
Okay.
Number 10, Trick or Treat. Okay, we're just going to go around the room.
Trick or Treat.
That's right. Sean, didn't he pick Trick or Treat?
I think he did.
I'm going with the real one.
The real one.
Trick or Treat, where Sammy Kerr is a heavy metal rock god who comes back from the dead to, like, kill people with his guitar. Rock. The power of his rock shoots out of his guitar. It's fucking awesome. You probably haven't seen it.
You can listen to our podcast.
Yes, there you go. Go back. It's on YouTube. It's got Gene Simmons and Ozzy Osbourne appearances in it.
Corky.
And I watch it every Halloween. I watched it the other night. I can't stop watching it. It's
Jesus
terrible.
Christ.
Number
nine. You listened to Fastway when I got here. Fastway!
Yes, I was. The soundtrack. Number nine. All right, so I know this is a new edition, but for the amount of times I've seen this movie, I'm going to put it on there. I'm going to go with The Witch. The Witch.
Whoa.
Well, okay, I made a movie called Witch Finder. So, I mean, this is in my wheelhouse, kind of. You know, it's like...
He loves them witches.
But I love that movie. Yeah, because Lords of Salem was also...
I love them witches. I do love them witches.
Love them witches. But yeah, that movie is creepy as all fuck. The people who didn't get it, I'm sorry, but it is unnerving as all hell. The production design is fantastic. It's one of those like transportive movies where you feel like you're looking at something, you know, through the portal into another time, which is really cool. Number eight, I'm going to go with The Return of the Living Dead. Woo-hoo. I think that's my favorite zombie movie. I know that, like, you know, Night of the Living Dead, you have to give massive props. And I've seen that in a way that, you know, it underscored to me, like, wow, when this movie first came out, like, this was terrifying. Because I saw it with a friend of mine who'd never seen it. And seeing it through his eyes was, like, an eye-opening experience.
You know why it's the best?
Return of the Living Dead?
Yeah, because it has more zombie characters almost than any other movie. Like... You can individually draw or pick out the types of zombies that are in Return of the Living Dead. Each one has something unique to its design.
Yeah. Well, you know? Because they're the Bernie Wrightson-inspired EC Comics type. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, and they talk. They have personality. I don't know. The whole more brains. You know, it's a very,
it's
a comic booky kind of zombie movie. Plus the punk rock thing. Is there a connection there? It's got a soundtrack that's awesome.
I'll actually tell you about the connection after the show.
All right, then.
It's not for you folks.
Number seven. I'm going to go with Fright Night over here.
Whoa.
Fright Night, is it my favorite vampire movie? It's the only one that's on the list. So I'm going to say, yeah, I think because of what I talked about earlier, I think... you know, for my generation, it's like Fright Night. It's a lot of fun. I think I like that kind of 80s vibe that both Return of the Living Dead and Fright Night have, and Trick or Treat. They're very fun horror movies. They're not very serious. They're not self-aware necessarily, but they have a playful sense about them. But they're also, I mean, Return of the Living Dead has an apocalyptic, creepy ending. It just like unnerved me the first time that I saw it.
It's almost like a Cold War movie, right?
Yeah.
It's almost like an anti...
Definitely.
Yeah. But Fright Night, it has a, I think it is the delineation of like the end of an era, but the birth of another one. That's really, I don't know, you know, I have to, but that's what it feels like, you know, kind of. And it's got cool vampire effects. And that scene in the nightclub is like classic. Love
it's the best actual like vampire hypnosis scene in the world. It actually shows what it's like for your woman to get fucking like.
There's nothing I can do. She's being taken away from me.
She don't even care.
Yeah. I should go back and say that reminds me Dracula and this 1979 Dracula and the remake of The Wolfman should be on a double feature somewhere. I'm just throwing that in there now. All right.
Remake of what? I don't think they did. What? I don't know.
Number six, speaking of werewolves, I'm going to say that my favorite werewolf movie is...
American Werewolf in London.
American Werewolf in London.
It's the greatest movie in the world. It's not even on my list. I don't even know how not.
No, because it's the ferocity of its titular beast. You know, I mean, like the horror is played like that's a horror movie mm-hmm. that has a really sharp comedic streak. It's not a comedy horror movie, right? Because, I mean, even Return of the Living Dead is like, it's a comedy for the first half, and then it becomes more of like a serious horror movie
See,
as it goes on.
I would say it is a comedy movie. It's just sensible comedy.
Which one? American
Werewolf? American Werewolf. Because there's some ridiculous shit in it, dude. Yeah. Like, the little kid says no.
That Jack
like,
does, I suppose.
Tell me, have you ever been beaten like, severely? Like, no, I thought not. Like,
I think it almost, like, walks a line of werewolf and body horror, though, because it's almost, like... It kind of treads that line because on the surface it definitely is a werewolf movie, but like the way that the characters in the movie deal with it is more like a body horror film.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I agree. Mm-hmm. It's very sharp. It's mm-hmm. very good. Best werewolf movie of all time. I know there's people who will vouch for The Howling from the same period of time. You're crazy.
Yeah.
That story's not great.
That just
movie.
Uses the sexy shit from vampires. What the sexy?
But what they
that
like
one was
about
capitalizing
it,
on a trend.
They like the bipedal werewolf design is like the first time that they ever got to see a werewolf. You know, like
The story's so weak, though.
Like... Yeah, it's a weak story. I hate that movie.
Yes,
I do not like that movie.
They don't have the guts to cut away and show you less of the transformation. They show too much, and it ends up looking really... Okay,
but anyway, it does look ridiculous.
All right, number five. The Shining.
The Shining?
Excellent choice.
The Shining I put on every winter. Not before Christmas. After Christmas, The Shining goes
when
on.
When the seasonal affective disorder is settling in really bad?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. I don't know. I suppose I do, though. That is probably what it is. But something about that whole idea of cabin fever or something. The Shining is one of the greatest horror movies of all time. It's fantastic because it takes place during the day, and it still works. I mean, I remember the first time I saw that movie, and like every single moment in that movie,
you just know they're out there by themselves. Moment. You know, that's why it doesn't matter if it's nighttime or day, they're out there alone. You know, you just get that, like, I mean, I haven't watched the movie since I read the book because I love the book. I don't know. I just love the damn book so much that somehow it ruined the movie for me.
Oh, yeah.
You know how that happens.
Yeah.
Right? To me, they're just so two entirely separate different things. Like, I think of that as like, this is a Stanley Kubrick movie. Mm-hmm. You know, that's how I think of it. So it's. I don't know. To me, in my mind, they're two separate things entirely. So,
yeah, I think his Kubrick's sense too and composition. I don't know that movie. Like I said, like I believe that every single moment in that movie is like just become a classic. I mean, it's quoted. I mean, anything you can pick almost anything out of that that's been quoted like in pop culture for the last.
There's some. 40 there are some things years. I think are genius about it. You know, like when Danny's riding his little trike and you can see how he's getting displaced throughout the fucking, you know, a lot of people think it's a editing mistake, but it's like, no, idiots, he's in a haunted hotel.
Yeah.
That's genius. Layers. It is genius.
Kubrick doesn't make those kind of mistakes.
Fuck no. Apollo 11 sweater. Well, you say that, I don't know.
He's in a reflection and Eyes Wide Shut in the bathroom. Yep. So,
but that was also the last, towards the end of his life. And,
yeah. He did like 700 takes of everything and he picked the one that, so number four, also a movie that comes around every, ironically, winter, The Thing. Thing's like possibly the greatest monster movie ever made because it has this monster that you can't ever pin down what it looks like and somehow that adds to its effect in your mind, you know? You see something there that isn't necessarily there. You extrapolate onto this thing. And it's ooey, gooey, icky, and it can get you. And it's got tentacles, and it's got claws, and it's got spider legs. It's just, you know, fantastic. The idea, the isolation, the paranoia, the very, you know...
Cold War, like, Invasion of the Body Snatchers sort of...
Yeah, it's got that kind of paranoia. But also there's...
That's why, I think it's the quintessential movie of the Cold War paranoia, even though it was made in the 80s. Like, he just took that sort of... John Carpenter just kind of took, like, what they were doing back then. And, I mean, almost did, like, what Spielberg had done to, like, you know... we always talk about how, like, they put heart in these atomic monster movies, right? That's what John Carpenter was able to do for the Cold War. It's like, he just took The Thing and fucking made it this, like, super, like...
Put the, oppressive terror.
It's almost like the score alone gave you the dread of, like, you know, one of us is this thing that's different from the rest of us, and it's going to take over all of us. You know, it's just like, it's like doom.
Plus, it also has the body horror thing, too. It's the fear of infection. You've got both of those things, I think. Like,
that's why what people say wasn't that popular, right? Is because it was so ugly and so, like, whatever, that people were so, like,
it was just, they were like, it's disgusting. That's the word on the street, I think, was like, it was gross.
And, which, you know, that's what you're looking for nowadays. Right. Yeah. I'm dying for a gross movie.
Yeah, it's the isolation of The Shining with, like, Cronenberg-level body horror.
Right?
Number three. All right, so this is maybe an outside choice, but I'm going to throw it in there because, to me, this is a horror movie, like, through and through. Seven. David Fincher's movie Seven is one of the most stylistically influential movies, I believe, of the last 20 years, where, like, you're still seeing this, that look now to this day. The, you know, I remember seeing it in the theater. I had been sold a different movie in the trailers. This is going to be a police procedural, like I've seen a bunch of times. And you get in there, and that opening title music video thing happens, and just the, we're not going to turn any lights on. It had, like, an X-Files aesthetic or something like that. But the murders, you know, the makeup effects by, you know, the great Rob Bottin. I mean, it, this is a horror movie about, it's a very dark night of the soul, and it has one of the most bleakest endings of all the, well, I don't know. American Werewolf's got a bleak ending. The Witch has a bleakish ending. The
bleak-ish.
Thing is
bleak the girl ending. Like goes to Satan. Yeah, it's bleak.
Well, it's happy for her.
Yeah. It's not happy for her. You don't know what going to Satan's like. Her soul will burn in hell forever. She's
ecstatic about it. Yeah.
Oh.
But yeah, one of the most memorable, uncompromising endings in movie history, next to The Mist. No, I don't know. Seven. Yeah. Number two. All right. So number two and number one frequently jockeyed for position. So I'm going to say number two today is The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I think that is one of the most intense, uncompromising horror movies I've ever seen in my life. I saw it at a drive-in theater last year, and I think at that point it actually clicked over like, oh my God, this is how this movie was always supposed to work. And it worked like unbelievably well. I mean, it's just so, you know, for like a, it wasn't a first time movie, but like you think of it as like a ragged kind of found in a dumpster kind of movie. It makes you feel like you have to take a shower after you see it kind of thing. And when you see it actually like cleaned up and projected, it's like, there's a lot of craft and care that went into this. I mean, it's really well put together, exceptionally well, you know, composed, edited and all this, but it's a movie that feels like it's been made by maniacs. Like you're right in the middle of madness and the movie wants to make you crazy by watching it.
That's great.
Yeah, yeah. I saw the 4K remaster in a drive-in last year as well. And like it was a completely different experience. Like it felt like watching a new movie again. I totally agree.
And it still works. Yeah. Like gangbusters. Oh, yeah.
It didn't make it like a new movie in the wrong sense. It just felt like watching the movie for the first time again.
Yeah. Totally. I just wonder, like, now it's like, you know, people have seen a lot of things, you know, that may have desensitized them to that kind of, but it's like a really strong movie.
If they made that sort of movie nowadays, it'd be like rated X or rated, you know, they just wouldn't make anything that extreme nowadays. You know, people freak out over like shit like Hostel and like it's got nothing over.
I mean, Evil Dead, the remake had extreme stuff, but it's fantasy, you know? I mean, like this feels not, like
it still felt like a different universe, so it didn't seem real, you know?
Yeah. This feels like, I mean, the closest thing to this in recent years is maybe The Devil's Rejects.
Yeah, but that's just because The Devil's Rejects is a complete fucking knockoff homage.
But that's the closest thing I'll ever get to see, like, a new movie in the theater where they had that kind of
effect. Because they'll never make that sort of craziness. That was only something that could happen at the time where Charles Manson was fucking, like, roaming the, you know, it's just like that was that world,
right? He is the godfather of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just, you couldn't have that movie without the Manson family.
Psycho, Ed Gein's the man that created horror movies for, he created the American horror movie. I do believe Ed Gein is the man responsible because everybody says, well, Friday 13th is Halloween. Well, Halloween is Psycho. You know, I mean,
it's like, do you guys ever like talk to someone who swears up and down that their grandparents have like newspaper clippings that Texas Chainsaw actually happened? Oh, it's like, no it idiots. Didn't.
It's just a scary fucking movie.
It like, has one of the most violent titles.
Yeah.
Of any, I mean, it's the perfect, I mean, the title sounds invasive. It's Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
One person gets murdered with a chainsaw? Just Franklin, right?
Off screen, kinda.
Everybody else gets, like, meat hooked like, or clubbed. Or
the dude gets clubbed. Yep. Or, yeah. I think Patton Oswalt said what's so perfect about Texas Chainsaw Massacre is if you could see the movie in your head when you just hear the title, like, you don't need to even see Texas Chainsaw Massacre. You hear the title and you're like, Jesus Christ, I know exactly what that is.
Right.
You know?
And what you see in your head is worse.
So what's your number one?
Number one is going to be
The Cemetery. Oh my God, Colin, no.
I don't know. See, well, I said that The Thing was the greatest monster movie of all time, but maybe I'm going to take that back. I'm going to say that my favorite.
You can't start switching around during your fucking list. You said it, you stick with it, God damn it.
All right. So, my favorite horror movie as of right now today is Ridley Scott's Alien. It is the ultimate, like, you know, fear of the dark, fear of the basement. You know, the drippy, you know, I mean, like just the atmosphere of that ship is it's going in the basement and down there is this insectoid thing that's as big as a man. I mean, it's just terrifying. And again, this is also, you know, again, all these movies, I think, aside from The Witch, I saw, you know, when I was younger, this one I remember seeing it on TV, remember hearing what sounded like my own heart was beating so loud I could hear it in my ears. And then I became aware that, like, that's on the soundtrack to the movie. It's the sound of, like, there's a heartbeat.
Yeah, there's a heartbeat. It's like, I want to say it's the fan, right? It's the cooling fans or something. It is genius. Because I constantly make fun of movies when they do the hello, hello. It's right. Like, that's when you know they're stretching a movie. But that whole movie is designed to be a hello, hello. But it's like, it makes sense. You're on a spaceship. You're out in the middle of nowhere, you know. Like, it works. You don't need to go to a special area of the house or, you know. And no, you can't leave the spaceship.
But it's also, like, the thing, the complaint I hear about it now is that it's very slow moving. Like, nothing happens for 40 minutes or whatever of the film.
Suspense does not mean slow moving.
Are you in a lot of suspense at the beginning of the movie? I mean, it takes its time unfolding, but, like, to me, it's full immersion, right?
Exactly.
You're dealing with the crew. The crew has a working relationship, and they're, like, stressed out at each other. Too.
Mm-hmm. It feels ad-libbed and real.
Because they feel like co-workers. Nowadays, they try to make characters seem like everybody's so involved in each other's lives. That movie, they're co-workers. Right. They're just, you know, they'll yell at each other, they'll whatever. They're not like, let's go off to the side and we're dating and, like, oh, you know, we need some character relation. It's like,
but there's also enough there that you can understand, like, who's actually friends with who, you know, within that group dynamic. Sure. It's like, who knew each other before, if they did, or, like, who would, you know, lean on who in a crisis.
Just like how in Aliens, you know, how that Mexican chick and that one dude are like this weird little solid group, right? Yeah. They just constantly have these things referring to each other, have little, like, high fives and shit they do. And you're like, oh, cool. Who knows? They went on missions together in the past. Yeah. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah. Is that Drake?
It's Drake. Whatever. I don't even know.
Yeah. So that's
your horror list.
That's my horror list.
The horror list. The horror could change. List.
Could change. But as far as the Freak Show knows, that's as far as we go. Next week. Next week, we may start a new promotional thing, but you'll have to stay tuned for that. And until then, we're going to say that it's going to be Travis's movie pick.
New promotional thing.
Yeah, we're going to do a thing where, like, people can write in and tell us what they'd like us to watch during the month of January.
Oh! You might regret that.
I know, we might. It just depends on how good they are.
So you want to
be good people. Well, we'll vote. They can write in as much as they want, but we'll vote on the selected.
You're going to get some trolls picking some awful stuff.
I will watch Troll 1.
So if you have made it this far, listener, you get the jump on everybody else. You can go to our Facebook page and just somewhere on there, make a post and tell us what you want us to watch.
We will not watch Troll 2.
We are going to do a viewer's choice month. So, Travis, what are we watching next week?
This episode is the Halloween episode for the audience, but next week is our actual Halloween episode, so there's no way I can go a Halloween without watching From Beyond the Grave, another great Amicus anthology movie.
All right. So that's next week on the Saturday Night Freak Show, and until then, ladies and germs, the basement is going dark.